Hello guys, welcome back to the Digital Aviator Virtual Flight School, and today we are going to learn how to make a simple navlog. So basically a navlog is a list of all of the waypoints you'll be visiting along your cross-country flight from one airfield to another, and you also calculate some data about each leg in between the waypoints. So for each flight in between two waypoints, we'll calculate the heading we need to be flying at, the altitude we want to be at, the distance that leg is, the time it will take us to fly that, all kinds of tools, or basically numbers that will help us in the flight when we have to find the next waypoint. And in order to create that simple navlog, and I say simple navlog because it's not the kind of navlog that you'll be using in real life, that is way more advanced than what we'll be doing for a simple simulator flight here. I might make a video about the real complex navlog in the future, but that's something that I need to learn as well. So I'm keeping things simple. This is what I've been using in the simulator, and it works very, very well, and it's fun. So let's get started. So we'll be using skyvector.com, which of course has the charts. We're currently on the Los Angeles sectional chart, but it also has some flight planning functionality. So what we can do here is we can right-click anywhere on the map, and it will select the nearest points of interest. So we have Palm Springs nearby, we have the Palm Springs VOR, the waypoint Baldy, or the actual GPS position I've clicked on. So I want to plan a flight from Bermuda Dunes to the untowered field French Valley, Foxtrot 70. It's another untowered field, so nothing special. It's a little bit larger than Bermuda Dunes. It's to the north of San Diego, to the east of Los Angeles. So, you know, it's not too far away. I think it will be a nice destination for our first cross-country flight. So, in order to plan, we can right-click on Bermuda Dunes, select Plan at Bermuda Dunes, and it will place our first waypoint. And as you can see in the flight planning window, it has automatically selected Kilo Uniform Delta Delta, Bermuda Dunes, as our destination airfield. Also very useful, we can now hover over this and we can see all of the extra charts for instrument approaches, obstacle departure approaches, blah, 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 in case we would use them for IFR flights. But also cool for any other airfield that's a little bit bigger, we have airport diagrams, so we'll talk about those later as well. But it's pretty pretty nice feature that Skyvector offers. So we have that in our list here. And of course, next we will select our destination. So again, we'll go to French Valley, right-click, and click Plan. And now we have Foxtrot 70 as a waypoint at our destination. And as you can see, it has drawn a line in between those waypoints. And it also has given us some information here. The distance is 44 miles, and the estimated time en route is 33 minutes. Now, the distance, of course, is just the distance from this place to this place, but the time of course can change based on the aircraft, based on the speed that you'll be flying at, and based on the altitude. So in order to get this more accurate, because it's not at the moment, we need to figure in or fill in the aircraft, the speed, and the altitude. We could also use fuel. Skyvector does fuel calculations, but we'll keep things simple for now. I will skip the aircraft for now. What you can do is make an account. As you can see, I'm logged in at the moment, and you can write down a tail number for a plane here. And as you can see, I've already done that for my Papa Hotel Alpha Victor Alpha. That's the Skyhawk I fly in X-Plane. And then you can click this button to fill in the exact performance data of that aircraft, and then it will very accurately calculate all of that data that you'll be seeing here. But what you can also do is just fill in the speed and the altitude you'll be cruising at, and then it will also quite accurately calculate the times for the whole flight and for each leg. So as you can see, my aircraft by default cruises at 110 knots. That is roughly the cruise speed, I think, in true airspeed that the Cessna Skyhawk flies at. You can be a little bit more precise, and I will show you where to get the exact number in one of the three next videos after this one. So I will leave 110 for now. That's a pretty good approximation for, you know, it changes with air altitude, but that's pretty good. And then we have our altitude to fly at. Now, we haven't really decided our altitude yet, so I'm just going to leave it at 8,000 feet, but we'll come back to this. The altitude, of course, is based on the distance of our flight. The longer we fly, the higher we want to be, because the higher you are, the better performance your plane gets. Just because there's less air, so you can go faster. But of course, for a short flight, you don't want to spend way too much time climbing, but you do it, of course, at a lower speed, and then descending right away. Then you would have actually lost some time. So only for longer flights, we would be at high altitude. So what we want to figure out is what kind of obstacles are we going to encounter along our flight. Just closing this here for the moment, because we are not done yet, because we just have this one line here right now. And that's nice. As you can see, we have some information. It's 44 miles. We know roughly how long the flight will take. We know the heading to fly at. So you would say, okay, well, I'm going to take off from Bermuda Dunes, fly a heading of 243 on my heading indicator, get over these mountains, and then at, what was it? When my timer, which I've started, says 29 minutes, we should expect to be at French Valley. That's, of course, not 100% how it works. Well, it kind of works this way, but this is way too long a lag for that to work. So what Skyfactor doesn't take into account is wind direction. Let's say we have a pretty significant crosswind from the north going to the south at our cruise altitude. Even if our heading indicator says we're going to 243 miles, or sorry, degrees, our actual track, the direction we actually fly in, will probably be much more to the south. And we would actually end up somewhere over here, maybe about 10 miles away from French Valley when our timer says 29 minutes. And then we might be lost. I mean, you know, we wouldn't know 100% that we indeed went to the south. Maybe I think, well, maybe I'm to the north. Hey, here's Hammett Ryan, but actually I'm mistaking it for Fallbrook. So this is a very easy way to get lost. That's why you want to split your legs into multiple segments. Just so that you have waypoints, reference points, so that you can reference where you are on the chart every, I would say, 10 or 20 nautical miles. So what we could do is select Lake Hemel or Hemel, not sure how to pronounce that, which is a visual reporting point as a reference point. So we would climb over these mountains and then make sure we indeed see this lake on the other side of the mountain. And then we know, okay, we're still on track. Maybe I see the lake to my right. Maybe I see the lake to my left. Then I can correct for that and more accurately get to French Valley. However, we do have these mountains here, and these are pretty high. These are about 7,500 at some points. Over here, way, way higher, of course, but this range is about 7,200 to 500. And that is pretty tall. And we need to climb above that. And that would probably get us above 8,000 feet, which is quite high. And I don't really want to be that high for just a short flight like this. Just because we'll be climbing. And then we have to descend right after that. So, you know, that's not very efficient. Another thing is, I'm not 100% sure if we can actually climb fast enough to reach this altitude before we get here. So there's a pretty good chance, especially if it's hot outside, so we have worse performance. Maybe we have a full plane, four people on board. Then, of course, our performance is way, way lower than with an empty plane. We might actually have to circle here for a minute or two, climbing above the mountain and then passing over it. So this is not ideal. So I want to figure out an alternative. So I would say, well, maybe we can go over here. So as you can see, you can drag out the line. You can just click on it, drag it out, and then you can place a segment anywhere else. So I'm actually going to select this GPS location here as a next waypoint. And as you can see, now I have a nice leg, which is in between 10 to 20 nautical miles long. And this is only up to about 5,600-ish feet at the highest point in this valley. It's a valley that's often a good reference point. It's easy to spot. We have this peak in front of it, so that should be easy to spot. But other than that, there's not really a lot of reference points here. And especially, you know, this lake is still 30 nautical miles. I want to have some kind of other reference point here. And there's not really a lot here to look for. We have these private airfield, but as you can see, this R symbol, when we look it up in the legend, is a non-public use having only an emergency or landmark value. So that usually means that it is a really small airfield, often dirt, I think. And we can actually open this up and see what kind of surface the Yeah, surface the runways. It's dirt, and as you can see on the satellite view here, it is not a very obvious airfield. It kind of blends in with the streets. So if we're flying over here, and we are trying to get, we were coming through this valley, I guess, and we're just looking around here, looking for reference points. Well, there's actually a lake there as well. So maybe this is a pretty okay waypoint, but I'm not 100% happy with that. So, a more experienced pilot would have no problems here, and I know this area quite well, so you know I wouldn't get lost. But for our first cross-country flight, we're going to keep things simple, and we actually want to train our pilotage skills. So we will have many waypoints to look for. That's of course what pilotage means. It is looking for waypoints, reference points on the chart, and finding them when you're flying as a tool of navigation. So instead of going to the south side of this mountain, we'll take the slightly longer route going to the north of this mountain. It's only maybe at most 5 minutes longer, I would say. But there's many more reference points along this part here, which makes flying just so much easier, a lot more fun. And we would have a lot of work to do when we're flying over here. That wouldn't really be nice, especially for our first flight. So let's look over here. So we have the Palm Springs airfield here, of course. We have roads to follow. That's always nice, big roads. We have this big valley here, the Benning Pass, kind of a funnel-shaped valley. This is easy to spot. We have a huge mountain on the right, huge mountain on the left, easy to find. We have the airfield Benning, which is a reporting point, so that is easy to spot. And then going towards French Valley from there, we have the village of Hammett. We have another reporting point, Hammett Ryan, that's easy to spot. Huge lake here, Diamond Valley Lake, another small lake here near French Valley, and then the field itself. So we basically have reference points no more than 10 miles apart from each other, which is of course what we're looking for. So this would be a really good alternative. So let's start to divide our flight into legs of about 10 to 20 nautical miles. So I would say my first waypoint would be Palm Springs International. And it will be 13 nautical miles. That's nice. But I do have an issue with this, because we have Delta airspace around it, which gets quite close to Bermuda Dunes. And it stops at 3,000 feet. Now, let's see how far the edge of the Delta is. It's about 8 nautical miles. I don't know the performance figures by heart, but I think this might be a little bit close, especially if we have a hot day and a full plane. We might not be able to climb above 3,000 feet before we reached it, this waypoint. So what I would suggest is, I'm actually going to remove this waypoint, which you can do by just removing it from the list. And I'm going to set my waypoint at the Palm Springs VOR. Now, even though we haven't covered VOR navigation yet, we can still use this, because we have a GPS on board of the plane. It will actually show an icon for the VOR. It will also show a circle where the airspace is. And basically what I want to do with this is we'll stay to the right of the airspace until we are above 3,000 feet. Then I'm going to turn to the left and fly over the airspace going into the Benning Pass. So at the moment we have reached 3,000 feet and above, we will fly over the airfield. But before that, we'll stay to the right. So this is our first waypoint then, the actual VOR. We'll still be able to see the airport from our left window very easily, so we can still use it as a reference point, but we'll actually fly around it. Then continuing onwards, we're also looking out for obstacles, of course. So we have some wind turbines, nothing over here to be worried about. Here's a wind turbine park with the highest at 2,000 feet. There's a few turbines here at also about 2,200-ish feet. So when we are above 3,000 feet, that should not be an issue for us. We do have this wildlife reserve. In wildlife reserves, you are requested but not required to stay, I think it is 2,000 feet above the ground. So, you know, we'll kind of stay clear of that. That's okay. We won't have to fly off these mountains anyway. And then we arrive at Benning. So I'm going to select my next waypoint to be the Benning airfield. Now that's a 21 nautical miles. I said, you know, you want to keep your waypoints about 10 to 20 nautical miles apart. You know, you don't have to be that strict. You know, this is easy flying area. Lots of roads going into the valley. Should be easy to spot. Let's see then, when we are at Benning, We want to probably split this leg up as well. It's 25 nautical miles. And as you can see, halfway there, we have Hamet Ryan. So let's select that. So as soon as we are bending, we'll turn to the left. We'll fly over this kind of higher terrain here. We'll have to figure out how high that is when we select our cruise altitude. But we'll keep the big mountain on the left. We'll kind of circle around that. Look for the village of Hamet. Small lake at the start of the village. Then, of course, the airfield. After that, we have the Diamond Valley Lake, which is a damn tough lake. And right after that, we should see another small lake after these hills. And to the right of that, from our perspective up here, we should see French Valley, kind of in the middle of the start of the next village. That is our navlog, or at least the waypoints we'll be flying at. And that's kind of my thought process when I select these. What kind of obstacles are there? Do we have to go around them? What kind of easy to spot areas do we have? How long is my leg? Do I want to split it up? So that's basically my thought process. And as you can see, from I think it was 32 minutes going through this valley here, we are now have 36 minutes, but it's an easier flight, so why not do it? All right, so there's one other thing that's missing, and that is our altitude, our speed we've already determined. So we know that we at least want to be above 3,000 feet, so maybe 4,000 feet. You of course don't want to be exactly at 3,000 feet, because then just 1 foot below that you would be in the airspace. So 4,000 feet it is. Over here we have no obstacles. As you can see, the terrain here at Benning is 2,200 feet, so we will be above that. But Benning is in this really light yellow terrain. Here we have some darker yellow terrain. And let's go to the left side, to the legend, and figure out how high that is. So the kind of darker yellow terrain is from 3,000 to 5,000 feet. So if we are flying at 4,000 feet, there is a chance that we'll be at or below the surface altitude. Now we can figure that out. Let's actually go to the terminal area chart, which makes it a little bit easier. We actually have a little mountain pointer here. So as you can see, we have these lines. These are called slope lines or something like that. And they are spaced out every 500 feet. So we saw that the yellow, the darker yellow, starts at 3,000 feet. So this line here is 3,000 feet. Then this here would be 3,500 feet. And then we have a very small point going above 4,000 feet. The same is true over here. This is 3,500 feet. This is 4,000. And as you can see, it peaks at 4,100 feet. So we have selected 4,000 feet previously. We'll get really close to the terrain here. We should be all right, but only just by a few hundred feet. And I wouldn't like that. And if we are just a little bit too far to the left, we would be, you know, hitting this peak. Of course, we would see it if the weather is okay, but just to make sure, I want to be at least 1,000 feet above the terrain here. So I will select 5,000 feet as my cruise altitude. But we're not there yet with our altitude, because there's two other rules we have to apply to our cruise altitude. So first we have to determine if we are going to fly VFR or IFR. Well, of course, we're going to do VFR. We haven't done any IFR training yet, so it will be VFR. So the there's the big issue when flying at a specific altitude is collision avoidance. And you want to pick an altitude where you will not be hitting other planes unexpectedly. So one situation where that could happen is if you are at the same altitude as another plane and you're both going toward each other. So you're coming from the right, another plane is coming from the left, going towards you. So you're basically approaching each other, and you have a very fast combined approaching speed. Not only that, the plane in front of you doesn't seem to be moving because it's coming straight at you. It's only getting slightly bigger over time. So it's also hard to spot and easy to miss. But you're coming both at each other at a very high combined airspeed. So only at the last moment you might spot him and you have to take evasive maneuvers. That's of course not a safe thing to be at. So that is why we have two types of separation. The first is VFR aircraft are separated from IFR aircraft. IFR aircraft usually fly a lot faster. They are usually commercial jets or turboprop. And VFR aircraft are usually just general aviation, small piston-powered airplanes that fly slower. So it makes sense to separate them. And that is why IFR aircraft fly at a whole 1,000, so 5,000, for example. And VFR aircraft fly at a 1,000 plus 500. So they're always separated above and below by 500 feet from the IFR aircraft. So if I've previously selected 5,000 feet, I would actually have to select 5,500 or 4,500, but that would only be about 300 feet above the terrain. I wouldn't like that, so I will select 5,500. That is one rule. The other rule is, again, now we might still have VFR aircraft approaching each other on the same altitude. I'm at 5,500 going towards the west. Another plane wants to go to Bermuda Dunes, and he is also at 5,500. He's approaching me. A lot of planes use this Banning Pass as a pass through these mountains, so that's quite a busy area. So we still have the issue of still colliding with VFR aircraft, and that is also why we have a different altitude restrictions when you go to the east than when you go to the west. And the rule is, if you go to the west, you select an even 1,000, so 4,000, 6,000, 8,000, 10,000, and so forth. And if you're going to the east, you select an old 1,000, so 3,000, 5,000, 7,000, 9,000, and so forth. And then you add your 500 feet to that if you're a VFR aircraft. So now that we know all of that, we have selected 5,500 initially. That's an old 1,000. 5 is an old number. So we are going to the west. We actually have to select an even 1,000. So 4,500 would work, but we were too close to the ground. And I'm actually select 6,500, which is still not that high. So we'll be nice and high above the terrain. This rule, by the way, only applies above 3,000 feet AGL, above ground level. So yes, I could stay just 1,000 feet above the terrain here and then descend with the terrain to stay below 3,000 feet above the terrain. That's perfectly fine, but the low altitude areas are usually very busy, and because there is no rule there for altitudes, it can be quite chaotic and dangerous. So even if you're flying within 3,000 feet above the terrain, which we would be over here, I'm still going to, in general, stick to those VFR altitudes, even though it's not required below 3,000 feet. So that is the story about altitude. So those are basically the two things we have to do in order to make our navlog. We select the waypoints to fly at, and then we select an altitude. So now we have determined 6,500. I'm going to write that in here as a flight level, of course. A flight level is in hundreds of feet, so when we type 650, that is actually 6,500 feet. And then we press enter, and now it is updated in my ETE. And I think it has actually made it better. Yeah, as you can see, we actually are saving 1 minute because we don't have to, we don't have to climb that far in contrast to climbing to 8,000 feet, which is where it was previously at. So that's actually good for us. All right, there's one other thing we can do, and let's click this button here, and it says Show Mini Navlog. So right now we just have these, the letters of each waypoint. When you click this, you get an actual navlog. This is what a navlog looks like. So we have our waypoints on the left, and then the lag information on the right. So we can see from Bermuda Dunes to the Palm Springs VOR, we should be flying at a heading of 299 degrees. It's a direct flight, which means we're not on an airway. It's 10.6 nautical miles long, and we will be flying that for 8.9 minutes. Now, if you've entered your aircraft specifications, you can also see the fuel usage in here, but that's quite inaccurate, and it would be better to calculate it yourself, which I'll show you in some of the next videos. So we see all of this information for each waypoint, which makes flying so much easier. We know by just glancing over here which heading to fly at, how long we would expect from now. For example, from Banning to Hamid Ryan will take us 8 minutes. So we can set a timer in the plane. And when we see 7 minutes, we should be able to see Hamid Ryan in front of us. Really useful tool. I will also make a video about the timer navigation later. It's really useful. All right, guys. So that is the navlog. I will make a few more videos about flight planning, and I'll try to keep them as short as possible. One thing I want to cover is getting more information about airfields. Just from looking at this, what are the runway headings? How long is the runway? Actually, we can see that here. But what do the taxiways look like? And the other information for this airfield. We'll do that in the next episode. And then I will make 3 videos, small videos, about a little bit about performance calculation. How much fuel do we need on board? Is the plane in balance when we load up people and baggage? Is it not too heavy? And of course also, how much runway length do we need to take off and land? Sometimes we have short runways, so can we actually land and take off at an airfield? So we have to calculate that if we think that might be a problem. So those are three other videos, actually four other videos that they will be making. And after that, we are going to plan a kind of a longer cross-country flight. And we'll do that by utilizing all of the things we've learned so far and by using a tool that I've made specifically for you that I will give out for free. It's not really a tool, it's just an Excel sheet, but it's really useful. And then we are of course going to fly that flight that we planned for in the video after that. So I have a few more videos planned in regards to flight planning. So after that, you know, we don't want to talk about theory and planning all of the time. We actually want to fly, so I'm going to go more into some maneuvers like spins, stalls, short field takeoffs and landings, crosswind, stuff like that. So there will be more flying after that. But for now, we'll finish off the flight planning section. So thank you for watching, and I will see you hopefully in the next video.